So, Dan, I thought we could kick things off with your best John Brophy story.
That's a great question. I didn't know if you picked that up, that I played there. Oh my gosh, I have so many. I don't know where to start. What a legendary character he was. I learned a lot from Broph, mostly how to like get away with dirty things without necessarily getting a penalty. I have stories almost every day for my fellow coaches about. I mean, if I remember him coming in once and just a brief interlude, something happened and a guy squared off and fought, and he was so mad that the rest of us didn't drop our gloves. And he said, every time one guy fights, everybody has to drop their gloves. So I wasn't a fighter. We had a pretty skilled team too. We had some tough guys, of course. And then, so everybody guys were from the other team were just looking at us like, what are you doing? Or like Brophy said to, and everybody,
so somebody fights and like literally the rest of the team would drop their gloves. Cause that was the marching.
Everybody on the ice had to drop the gloves and grab on. But so that was the kind of, he was old school, of course. Man, what's the best story? He threatened us with the whole team with murder one time after we lost 6 games in a row.
Do you still do that? Is that still allowed as a coach today?
I don't think it's, I think it's frowned upon. no death threats anymore. That doesn't fly. We won that game. We had lost 7 in a row and he called us in 3 hours early. And we're all sitting there. Oh boy, what's going to happen now? And he came in his suit, in his impeccable suit. And he said, I got a bad feeling about the game today. Got a bad feeling. I would say, okay. And he said, if we lose today, someone's gonna die.
Oh my gosh.
And then just in case there was so we're all looking around, a little bit of kind of guys like, okay, kind of smiling underneath there. And then he said, just in case we didn't pick it up, he said, if we lose, there's gonna be murder. So that was basically why we were there 3 hours before. And then we went out and came out absolutely hot, just flying. We got up 4-0, I think. And then I think the third period started and we were up 4-1. And I think thoughts of first, maybe the adrenaline wore off a little bit. And then I think thoughts of repercussions of losing came in and we really tightened up. They got 4-2, 4-3. And then we hung on to win 4-3. And he came in after the game and just said, good effort, boys, and left. That was it. No, nothing. He didn't note it at all about what he had said before. Just good game, boys, and walked out. And we were all like, holy cow.
I almost feel like we need a disclaimer right now to say that the Glasnost podcast is not advocating for anybody to use murder as a strategy or motivational tactic. But I think you're probably the third guest that we've had on the show that played for him. And it almost like on cue, everybody's just like, oh my God, I get to like every day was a new story and over the top. But I'm curious because like we're going to dive into your championship season last year in Košice. Am I saying that right?
Close. Košice. That's the S is like Košice.
Got it. Okay. Because it looked like you guys had a blast post-championship. But first, you won a ECHL title in Hampton, the Hampton Road Whalers. And I would just, again, in that part of the world and it's sort of a non-traditional hockey market, what was that like winning a championship down there? Because my sense is for some of these markets, particularly in the South, like to them, like they don't know the difference between the Stanley Cup and the East Coast League title. Like it's just, we won, baby.
Yeah. So we played in... I mean, it's the Norfolk Admirals now. It was the Hampton Roads Admirals then. We all lived in Virginia Beach, on the beach. It was about 20 minutes away, and the rink is the Scope in Norfolk. And so we weren't really we didn't spend any time in Norfolk unless we were at the rink. So I'm not sure. And we had a pretty good fan base of like I don't know. what our average was then. It was my first couple of years of playing, so I wasn't as aware of things like that. But it was probably 3,500, 4,000 a game. Not bad at all. But they were mostly from the Norfolk area, so we didn't really interact with them much except for fan events. Just super nice people, just really Southern hospitality down there. But, you know, we didn't see them on a daily basis. So we won on the road. We won in Florida. So we came back a day and a half after we won, and there was a fan event, and that was great, but there was no like parade or anything like that. So it was, we just went down to the beach and celebrated for another week or so and had some fan events. But yeah, it was a little different than here where the whole city comes alive. And
I think it was your team put out a video. And it sort of captures everything from you guys winning to the parade. And I mean, man, it looked unbelievable. I mean, and you were talking about before we hit record here that, you know, this is a very, I guess, historic franchise. It sounds like not just in the Slovakian League, but probably in terms of clubs overall in Europe.
Yeah, I mean, back in the day when it was Czechoslovakia and the Czechoslovak League, they were a powerhouse. Košice was one of the top two or three teams in all of Czechoslovakia. So they were a powerhouse, and then it split into Czech and Slovakia, and they won a bunch in the early 2000s, and then they won three or four like little mini dynasties. Sure. I think they won 3 out of 4 years in around 2010, and then it dried up. And it had been when I took over, not last year, but the year before, I took over late in the season, and they hadn't won the or gotten to the semifinals. They hadn't won the quarterfinals in 6 years. So we built a little momentum. We got to the semis, and Slovan Bratislava, the eventual champions, beat us in seven. We had a great series. What a fantastic hockey. It was a great series. We lost in overtime in game seven. So heartbreaking, but awesome. We got so much out of our players. And then we took that momentum into last year. There was some expectations there. And there's always a lot of kind of, even though it had been a while, the fans expect the team to do well. And they're fairly quick to be disappointed, which is fair. I mean, a long history of...
I feel like that's every like fan base, kind of blue blood fan base.
Yeah, that's true. But I mean, there's certain teams who will support the team. Teams that don't have a long history of championship, they have their hardcore fans who will support their team no matter what. If you're struggling, they'll let you know about it, that's fair. That's fair. So we, to talk about the very end result, the crowd, the fans, the support just swelled and swelled through the season, and was unbelievable. The whole community just rose up to support us. We had hundreds of people waiting as we went on the bus on a road trip, just cheering us out of the gates on our bus. And we had our autograph session we had after we won the championship was not like nothing I've ever seen. People were lined up for miles. We were signing autographs for like 5 hours. We thought it would be 2-3 hours, and we had plans for dinner, you know, and we had to order in pizzas and get the guys some beers for stamina builder to keep going through the evening. We signed autographs till like midnight. It was incredible. The fans are just fantastic.
Wow. Well, and I was going to say, because, I mean, the population's about, I think, what, 250,000 people. Yeah. So, I mean, when you talk about, to your point, like when things are going good, it's obviously you got lineups for miles. But at the same token, when, you know, you hit a bit of a dip, I imagine, you know, when you go to get milk at the local supermarket, people probably recognize you and probably have some feedback or recommendations on, you know, what to do on the power player.
Oh, yeah. For sure. The power play. That's a good one. I do. Even when we're doing well, I get some feedback about the power play. So usually we don't shoot enough, which is pretty common everywhere. You can shoot the puck more, but And then I usually use the slap shot, the Reg Sunlop. Like, yeah, we're working on it.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Well, I'd be curious on that note. So traditionally on the big sheet of ice, European hockey, it seems to be, you know, much more of a, I don't want to make comparisons to soccer or football, but, you know, the pace seems to be a little bit slower. You wait for that opportunity. So I'm just really, I'm kind of intrigued by that people want you to shoot more, because my sense is that particularly in European hockey, you hold onto the puck until you get a grade A opportunity. Is that accurate or a fair assessment?
Well, the PP is different for sure. You have so much more. There's more teams who play a diamond rather than a, you know, a push down or the flush down. We typically do North American style systems in everything we do. So my philosophy here on the, so our ice is big, our ice surface is big here. It's interesting thing about our, in Košice, it's a large ice surface, Olympic style. But in our league, there it varies. Like when I coached in Banska Bystrica, in Banska Bystrica, where I was there for 2 years and won a championship, it's a North American size ice, like very, very small, way smaller. So 3 meters less on each side. So it's completely different there. And so it's kind of fun tactically to go to the different buildings and different, so we try to use the width of our ice more. Also, like when you're shooting from the wall, strong side wall in the offensive zone, that's a long way to go. You're 3 meters farther outside. We want to get the puck between the dots more so to shoot. So we don't shoot a lot. Like that's our philosophy. Don't shoot unless we have a quality shoot, or at least a shot between the dots. We hang on to it a lot and try to get ozone possession time. So that's a difference rather than just, you know, funneling pucks to the net. And because so many shots get blocked now when you're shooting from the wall, it's that much farther to the, so there's definitely some tactical differences. We don't use the wall very much to break out either. Like I don't like to rim pucks at all. We support the puck close and then we make short passes. I don't like rimming the puck. And that, I mean, I had a bit of that in Banska Bystrica too, but of course in a smaller rink, you're going to have to chip it out. Everything happens a bit quicker. So you're going to have to use the glass and the walls more often.
Well, I was mentioning, so I watched a bit of the video. I guess it would have been game 5 last year in the final. And again, it's a big aerial view. And when you talk about like that box, it seemed to me that the opposition was very much just keeping 5 players inside the dots, almost in the block. And there wasn't really a lot of pressure in the D zone unless there was a loose puck or perhaps a player turned his back to the play. What would be the strategy that you deploy to get the puck to the middle of the ice or to try and create a grade A opportunity and sort of break through that?
Well, I mean, there are more soft areas because it's bigger. So the F3, the high slot area, the honey hole is harder to cover. And there's a lot of teams have a real gray area, a shared coverage between their, you know, slot forward and their net front D. Who's going to cover that spot? We cover it with our slot forward. So if you cover it with your slot forward, then you need to get puck pressure. Otherwise, the weak side D is going to be active and be open a lot. So because we play pure zone. So, we got to, even on the big ice, we want pressure. We don't want to give teams time. We want to get the first guy and we play zone, one guy on it, two guys on it as quickly as possible. Of course, we get into, if we're tired, second period, we get a long shift, we're caught out there. That's when we get into a little bit of problems, especially covering the backdoor guy when our slot forward is covering the slot in the high slot in the F3. There's a lot of difference. There's more movement and reloads and stuff everywhere. I'm a Leafs fan, so I watch the Leafs quite a bit, and they're constantly popping up and moving in the offensive zone. So we try to get as much movement as possible, get our F3 popping up, get our D diving down, get movement to open things up and get some confusion. So that's more how we try to get quality chances.
Yeah. So you've got a bit of a unique track record in that it seems that, if I owned a club in Europe, I would hire you because it seems like you win a championship within a minimum a year and a half of going to a new club. So you've turned the trick in Denmark twice now in the Slovakian league. When you first join a club, what might be one of the first parts of the game structurally that you look at to, whether it's implementing, something, a strategy that's unique to you that's worked in the past, or perhaps just to say, hey, we're going to focus on this area first and get settled in that area before we start looking at other parts of our game?
Well, I think back to when I took over here, I feel like, because you were talking about prototypical, like stereotypical European hockey that, it's a little bit slower for build up. That's not necessarily, that's kind of what it was about 10 years ago. You think about Swedish hockey, a lot of regroups, a lot of hinges.
Yeah.
Well, the Swedes don't do that anymore at all. All the top teams in Sweden are heavy forecheck, 2-on-2s everywhere, pressure, no set breakouts at all. They're flushing constantly. It's super entertaining. There's no space. I mean, they skate so well, they can do it on the big ice. It's constant pressure. It's just as aggressive or more than in North America. So the North American style has been successful. So, of course, just like anywhere, more and more teams adopt that style. So that's what happened here in Slovakia. Before I took over Banska, they'd won the two previous titles as well. And they were playing for the coach there was a guy named Vladimir Orzog. He's in Trinets now. He won a championship with Trinets and a former NHL player. And so he brought North American style game to Slovakia. More teams were playing stretch out their wingers and lots of regroups and take your time on the build up. And he brought straight lines and chip and chase if you have to, and heavy forecheck and coming down the walls. And then, of course, they won a couple of times, and then we won again when I took over. And so more teams adopted that. And the team that won more recently, Zvolen, after I left Banska, Zvolen won. They played that style. So a lot of teams play North American style here. Rather like mostly north, playing fast. We don't necessarily, I was just talking to the players about this today. We want to play fast, but we don't want to play too fast. We don't want to be out of control, which because we have a pretty skilled team. We have a nice mix of grindy guys and skilled guys, but we want to go north, but we also want to support underneath the puck all the time. And if we have to bring it back, especially on an initial breakout when we're under pressure, we pass it behind. We bump it back, short passes, bump it back, and then go. When we start getting above the puck and we're playing too fast, then we get out of control and we can't use our skill as much. So it's a fine line between playing fast and playing too fast. I find at our level anyway, with the players that are in this league. So to answer your question about what do I focus on first? It's puck support. I really found that they were starving for more detail in the game. So a lot of video and honesty in the video, not ripping into guys, but showing mistakes. And of course it was late in the season too, and they wanted to win. So it was right away. I couldn't be nice, too nice about it. We had, when I took over, there were 5 games left, so we had to fix everything fast.
Wow, really?
Yeah. They made a move late. As you, in your email, you said about the volatility of coaching in Europe, they're not afraid to make moves. So because I had been fired in Linz, I was coaching in Linz, and I had 3 months I didn't work. And I pretty much thought, I'm waiting until next season. It's the playoffs are almost starting. So I got my agent called and said, they want you in Slovakia. I'm like, where? Košice. I'm like, really? Okay. Interesting. I knew a couple players that had played for me in the past. And so I touched base with them and said, yeah, we need you. So I came over and had a good run in the playoffs that year and then won a championship last year. So, So puck support, accountability in through video sessions, and playing north as sensibly as possible.
Andrew, so when you go into practice, you mentioned video. Would it be fair to say that video is perhaps the best way to illustrate when you talk about just playing in control? But in terms of maybe some of that decision making, is that something that you can touch on or recreate those scenarios to help players with their decision making in practice and how that might translate?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. I mean, a lot of teams still stretch out their wingers here, and I'm very anti-stretch. And that's for, well, I have, there's a difference between stretching strategically and cheating, of course, but I don't think you can win a championship with a team that cheats. I just don't think it's possible. I think you're hoping all the time that you create offense, easy offense, and a good team is going to shut that down. So if you have a lower end team, then you might have to cheat and just try to defend the net front and then get the pocket. For example, we played in Champions League, and I've been in it quite a few times, and we have to blow the zone more. So we're not cheating, but we have to incorporate more where our D get it and our wingers go, because we're at a major disadvantage for, you know, on a one-to-one basis against those teams with 10 times our budget. So, you know, we have to try to find some easy offense. But for us, we don't cheat. I mean, and that's more individual video. You don't want to center out a guy in a group setting and say, you know, we can't cheat. Not much anyway. But for example, just guys leaving the zone, and we want five in the picture and video all the time. And so that's repetition. Guys just have a habit, or maybe they've played in other teams that, you know, try to push the pace and get their winger out and push back the D, and that's a valid strategy as well. And we will slash through, but we don't want to just send a guy up to the far blue with no real plan. Sure. Because the D's going to throw it up there. He's on an island. Maybe he chips it in, or he has to play it backwards, which we don't really want to play south very much. So we're tight. So we do a lot of drills. We do a lot of small area games in the kind of recreating the D zone, where it's almost, I got a favorite one it's more of a like a keep away game, where there's three guys chasing and five guys just tick tacking around in like one half of the ice, or from the weak side post to the wall, and they're just moving the puck around. And then if the three guys get it, they attack the net. We go into our defensive structure. But that's really getting used to making those small passes and supporting the puck in those small areas. And then we can explode out of the zone and attack as a unit. So, and there's, I mean, almost every drill I do has some kind of element of getting back to the puck and supporting the puck.
I'm just taking notes here. I love that. I might pick your brain afterwards for that drill. We met some members of the Slovakian Federation last year at the World Championships, and really struck me that highly organized, seemed to have, and I sense there's a bit of a new regime there, and sort of, you know, there was a real emphasis to try and build the program back up. But, you know, some very unique ideas that I sense were unique to Slovakia. And I'd be curious to know, like, if we were to open up your coaching toolbox, what's in there that is a product of spending, you know, the last number of years in the league and winning a couple championships?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, there's a little bit of a disconnect between the Federation guys and the national team and us club teams. I don't really deal a whole lot with them. They're doing a great job with the national team. It's not a negative comment. I just don't have much. Sure. interaction. Maybe
just in terms of like the hockey culture in general, just from coaching, well, whether it's picking up from other coaches or.
Yeah, well, so when I got to Banska Bystrica, I mentioned Vlady Orzag. Yeah. He's a great human being. That was kind of my step up into the next level of coaching in Denmark. Denmark's good hockey, but you know, it's let's say middle lower in Europe, and then Slovakia is upper middle for sure. So Vlady really was completely open book. So I learned, I was taking over a team that had won two championships, so I wasn't going to go in there and change things just to change things. I changed a few things on our penalty kill strategy that I liked better. And that was about it. Like I just adopted all of his, which were mostly similar to what I was running anyway. Like I said, it was North American style, but some little details. So he helped me a lot. So I found that in Banska, my biggest learning curve was dealing with older and more established players. That was more of a challenge than the hockey X's and O's for sure. Dealing with egos and, trying to, also there was a language barrier as well. It was really interesting going to Banska. It was a big, yeah. I mean, so that for that team, the ownership really wanted me to do everything in English, but having everything I said translated into Slovak.
So my you have a translator?
Yeah. Well, my assistant coach was the translator. It was a guy named Ivan Dropa, who played a bit in the NHL for Chicago. Yeah. Great guy. And he's fluent in English, but it's still not easy to just translate into Slovak. And also, of course, hockey lingo. He's trying to find the lingo. Some is universal breakout or.
Oh, I know. I can imagine. Yeah.
He was trying to, like, he spent a lot of time trying to figure out what words he could use. And he was been playing in North America, and he just used the English words. So he was like, what's a cycle? What do you say for cycle? And he came up with like rotation or, you know, rotation. Yeah. So he did a lot of work and got really good at it. It was interesting too, because I had to I had to figure out how to make my presentation shorter, because it was twice as long, because he had to say everything again in Slovak.
Oh, yeah, that's a great, yeah.
Yeah, which is a good process for me, because I tend to overdo my video as it is. Yeah. So that was good to be able to try to shorten up my video sessions. I'm not a long-winded speaker, but the video tends to get a little bit long for me. So that was good for that. The emotional, I'm kind of an emotional guy, so that was interesting too. When I'm saying something in a heated way, and Ivan would have to try to say it, but he couldn't recreate that kind of, yeah, try to convey it. And he's a laid back guy. So it was pretty interesting. We got better and better as we did it. And there were some Slovak players who, not a lot, but three or four who the management was worried that they'd feel left out or be confused, but more the emotional aspect that we're catering to all the English speakers and they're just kind of not part of the team. Which was a valid point. And so we did everything. Everything was translated and it worked well. Here we don't do that, but we don't really have any players who can't speak any English at all. So they can pick it up. But it was a big challenge. It was really interesting just year in general with learning stuff, not the X's and O's, like I said, but more dealing with players who can't speak English that well, dealing with we had some veterans that had been around for a long time, maybe had seen their better days. So I had to deal with them, trying to make them feel still part of the team and great. They were great leaders. So yeah, it had a lot. It was a real learning experience that year and it really built my knowledge base and ability to coach.
Can you give some examples maybe of, maybe not a specific conversation, but perhaps how you would have, when you talk about those veteran players that, again, I mean, I think we can all relate to, I mean, everybody's got an ego. And certainly if you've had success, whether as a hockey player in any industry, it's tough to maybe accept that you're not playing a role that you once did. How did you approach that and reframe it in a way that it might have been saying, hey, you're not going to play that same role, but you're still integral in anything we accomplish?
Just communication. I mean, it's daily. I mean, every coach on here is probably talking about, I know you had Roger Ronberg, who's an unbelievable coach. And I know I've seen a presentation or a couple by him, and he talks about how important communication is. So that was, I mean, that I tried to put them, be aware of their need to be involved. So, you know, keep them involved on the ice as much as possible, but just communicate with them. And they were super competitive guys, and they wanted to win. They really wanted to win, all the guys I'm speaking about. So, and they had a good leadership group. They pushed each other. So they were, I mean, the most credit is to them. They really wanted to win another championship. So they were amenable when it was approached in the right way to taking a lesser role or whatever it may be. You know, sometimes if it's a 50-50, you got to keep the guy on the power play for sure, because that's what he's played his whole life. So it was a balancing act, and it got tense at times. My first team in Banska Bystrica, we were stacked too. We had a lot of talent. We had guys in the stands who had been playing, you know, had played KHL games, and they were healthy scratch. So it was hard. Yeah, it was hard. So it was just a lot of talk, a lot of communication, a lot of trying to get them to understand and buy in. I got to give them a lot of credit. I mean, I'm still coaching some of those guys here. Like I've brought a handful or more, slightly more than a handful of guys here to Košice who I coached in Banska, because they're such good people. They have such a winning mentality. So I've built the team here with guys of character.
Well, so this is the thing that I find complexing about coaching in Europe. And I say this because it's not just Europe. I think it's coaching by nature. But in particular, I mean, you mentioned it sounds like you've built some terrific relationships with your players, just by the way that, you know, you mentioned that when this opportunity arose, that the first thing you did was call some players and they said, hey, we need you here. That speaks volumes. I don't know if you can get a better recommendation than that as a coach. But when you're in an environment where, maybe not everywhere, my sense is in Europe, like, gosh, you start losing, you string three losses in a row, that like the hot seat gets really, really hot over there. How do you balance that sort of just that relationship building with the players? Because obviously they know that if things aren't going well, if it's not going well for them personally, that, man, we can get a new coach.
Yeah. I mean, that's a tough one anywhere, but for sure in Europe, they're pretty quick to make decisions. So our league this year in Slovakia, there's eight new coaches right now.
There's 12 teams.
Beginning of the year. There's 12 teams. It's seven teams. One team, Slovan Bratislava, has replaced their coach twice now. But they don't have a new coach yet, but they've released their second coach. So there's been one was Doug Shedden, who left on his own. So there's been six teams have fired seven coaches, and then Doug Shed's left on his own to go back to the DL. But they're very quick, very emotional. I mean, I think that's you see teams that are managed, like the upper management, are not hockey people. They're fans. They're super passionate about it, and they do a lot of work. They're also teams are run by a small group of people as well, who have to work a lot. So they put a ton into it of their personal time and money in a lot of cases. So they get really upset in a hurry, and maybe the fans have a little bit too much influence on some of these decisions, because they're quick to turn on coaches. And then the teams and the teams that are most successful in my mind are the teams that will stick with a coach and build it and help build a culture. Because here, I think a culture in North America, NHL teams anyway, it's built from the top down. But kind of here, when management is more like just the money guys and kind of fans, the coach brings the culture. So when you're constantly changing coaches, I mean, what's the culture? Like that. So when I came here, that was my question. What culture are we trying to build? And they're like, well, what culture do you want to build? And I talked about what my key points were. And I said, so when I signed here originally, it was just for the rest of the season. It was 5 games left, rest of the season. Gives me a chance to see what it's all about, and gives them a chance to see what, I mean, they knew me from Banska Bystrica, but I thought that was the safest, because you never know with organizations over here. So we did well, and then we talked about signing a contract for the next 2 seasons, and I said we need to really get some stability here. So I looked online, and they hadn't had the same coach in training camp. They'd had a coach be like take over halfway through and be at the next training camp. They hadn't had the same coach for 2 training camps in a row in like 12 years.
Come on.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And that's not all the same management. Management had changed a little bit, so I'm not blaming anyone in particular.
But clearly that's not a secret to anybody. I mean, that's accessible information. Like it's so funny. I struggle with this. I'm like, how could anybody, I don't care if you're operating a corner store or a hockey team, having that amount of turnover as leadership, I mean, who would say, who would think that that's conducive to achieving good results?
Yeah. That's right. I heard about some kind of seminar that Roger Rundberg did to there's some kind of group of a management conference. Yeah. So it's all the GMs and owners that go to a conference. I can't remember the name of it, but Roger did a speech there, and he blasted them. I've heard this through the grapevine that he blasted them. Like, you guys.
Oh, I think this was the Alliance of European Hockey Clubs event.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
And he said, how can you expect to build a culture when you're turning over the coaches all the time? So, and that's exactly the point. So these guys, our management are intelligent businessmen. They're good people. And they agreed totally. And they had trust in me, which they weren't just hiring some guy they didn't know at all. So, so that came into play last year. So, we started the season really badly last season. So energy crisis was going on, and so we have this big, beautiful building, and we pay a lot in rent. We don't own the building. A private company owns the building, so we pay a lot. And energy crisis came. We had started training camp and everything, and the rink told the club that it would be approximately 3 times higher, which was
wow.
I don't want to say the numbers, but it was a lot.
Yeah,
and it would have been more than quite a few teams in our league's whole budget just on rent. So our management said, no, that's impossible. And they said, okay. And we left and went to the practice facility. So we came back. We're in a tournament in Sweden, a preseason tournament. We came back and we're told by management, so like, sorry. I mean, I got a heads up, but the players kind of came in. We gave them a day off after Sweden. Said, pack your bags. We're going to Crow Arena, which is this practice facility nearby, and it's not a professional setup. It's one dressing room. Like, the players had to take off their winter boots and put them in their stall. There was no cloakroom type idea or locker room area, pre-locker room. So it was a major blow to the guys' psyche. The guys were good about it. They kept a brave face, but it had an effect. So, and especially because I had recruited some guys. And my major recruiting pitch was, you're coming to the most professional team in Slovakia, more professional than some teams in the DL and wherever, in higher leagues, and you're going to be treated the right way. Everything's going to be professional, beautiful building, great facilities. We have a great dressing room here. We got a spa in the back and everything. So all of a sudden, we're in this tiny little rink with freezing cold, and it was hard. So we lost 4 games in a row to start. The season was starting in less than a week.
In that facility.
Yeah. Yeah. Fans didn't come. It was a bad rink to watch a game in. And we kind of had a feeling. I mean, it was 1,800 or 1,500 seat rink. We thought it would be full. No, fans just said, no, we're not going to go watch for this same ticket prices too. We're just not going to go. It's freezing cold, bad sight lines. So nobody went. And so it was dead quiet. The sound system was bad. It was a real struggle. And so we lost our first 4. I'm new coach, basically, new team. We spent some money on our players. We had some high-level players from the DEL, and we had and have a player from Swedish Elite Leagues, some good players, high-level players, and high expectations. We lose 4 in a row. And then we won one. Looked like okay, and then we lost a couple more. We were 2-5. So in whatever place we were, 10th, we were 2 wins, 5 losses. We had an emergency meeting, and we're losing money. Of course, we got no spectators, so management is really nervous. What should we do? Do we have a chance to turn this around? I said, let's stay calm. Give us a chance to get out of this. It was weird too. We had lost those 4 games, and we were first in the league in shots for, and first, the best in shots against. Our shot differential was huge. We just were not scoring. We couldn't score. It was something mental going on about trying to get over this hump of moving to this mental hump of getting to this new arena. It was really a strange phenomenon. Then we finally started winning, and then we just caught fire. So, but the team got a lot of.
Did you get back? Obviously, you didn't play playoffs.
Right. Yeah. So that was sometime in November. The management here worked really, really hard to work out a new deal, to find some extra money, because the agreement was somewhere in the middle for the rent. So we still had to find more money to run the team. So they did an awesome job of supporting us and supporting the team financially. And, it was sometime in November, and that was a nice boost too. We'd started winning anyway, but then all of a sudden we're back in our nice arena, nice dressing room facilities, and with the gym in here. That's the thing too. We had no gym. It was just really just everything was more difficult. So then we moved back here and we caught fire, and then it wasn't exactly smooth the whole rest of the way. We had a little down period, as teams do, and kind of the doldrums of late December, early January. We kind of hit a little slow patch, but then we caught fire towards the end again and then rolled right into the championship. But the ups and downs of a season and adversity. So they got credit. The management got a lot of credit for not firing me after 7 games, which I was like, I mean, yeah, I give them credit too, but I think it would have been insane to fire me, but other teams definitely would have. So yeah, it's a pretty cutthroat environment in Europe in general, in Slovakia for sure. But every year it's a battle.
Well, tell me about, like, I think we all appreciate, you know, the role that having character people plays in, you know, championship teams. And I mean, you can always sort of, you know, I always find that coaches tend to lean more towards skill and or more towards character. Can you maybe articulate when you say that you wanted a lot of character people, you're bringing players from your past into this dressing room. When you go on a championship run like you did last year, like where's that influence of character and how does that influence winning?
Oh, in a major, major way. Like we do. Me and our sport manager here, Gabby Spiller, we do a lot of research on our players, and more than some teams, not more than everybody, but we do a lot. And I've been doing this for 14 years now, so I get a lot of people in North America I can call. You know a lot of coaches, so we really look at care. I mean, everybody can watch video now on Instat. You watch the games. But still, you got to make the phone calls and as many as possible and find the right guys. Because it doesn't take, I mean, sometimes it takes one guy who's, you know, got lazy tendencies, especially if he's a top guy, that you can't, that's not going to respond to coaching, that can really ruin a team, a dressing room. Is it one, and one guy gets to do it, other guys get to do it. And that's, of course, the coach has to keep guys accountable. But some guys, I mean, they're like that their whole careers, and they just don't buy in. And that, and you, if you make a few calls, you find that out. Of course, the real bad apples. But I mean, there's just other guys who, you know, you even watch, we watch body language on video, and we want the real right types of people. Now, we're top three in budget in the league, so that gives us some leeway. For sure, some teams with a lower budget have to take more chances because they might have, a guy might be cheaper because he's got a bad reputation. He might have to, you know, pros and cons and weigh that out. For example, like when I was in Austria, we had to, you know, figure out, is that kind of small risk worth, is it willing to take? We're lucky. I mean, we have a pretty healthy budget, so we can find the right amount of skill and just have no room for guys with even questionable characters. So we got a great room. I just did a little thing with the guys today about how special our room is and how that's why we're here. Why do you guys come to the rink every day? And I thought I might have to bring it out. One of our guys said no, the video sessions, but he was obviously joking. Yeah. it was pretty quick. I had some plan if guys didn't answer, give the right answer first. But right away, guys were like, because the guys, the players, that's what I look forward to, coming to the rink every day and seeing the guys. And that's, if you can harness that, like last year we had a great dressing room, this year we have a great dressing room. And if you can harness that, then they're really playing for each other. And then that takes care of so much of the coaching job. I mean, we have great leadership too. We have got some older guys who are, I wouldn't say they're hard on their teammates. I think that's getting less and less, the Mark Messier type guys who, you know, yell at their teammates, which is, it's nice to have that too in the dressing room, but it's rare. I think now everybody wants to be respected and liked. But we have a solid dressing room, and it was just, yeah, that was a focus point today, and I'm going to make a poster about it because we're in a little bit of a doldrums here right now. We lost 5 in a row.
I saw that, yeah. You guys are having a great, I just point out, you guys are having a great year, and because I think you're in second, like you're just, you know, neck and neck with the first place team. You know, what have you learned? Because I mean, you're a veteran at this now. When you go through those dips, how do you respond? And I'm so curious about this because you talk about Roger Ronberg. And when we did that, had that interview with him, and I think I touched on it in our conversation, that I had watched some practice clips. I don't speak Swedish, but I knew, like, through his tone, his body language, I appreciated perhaps the message he was trying to get through. And I would think, like, in an environment where not everybody, where English isn't their first language, that when you're going through a dip, like you're probably, your body language, your tone probably carry more weight than they might if you were coaching in North America.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think that carries over. And so that can be more important than what you say sometimes, especially on the, during a practice when not everybody really hears you.
Yeah.
I would love to have that voice that just carries through the whole rink, but I don't. Yeah. I know that when I stand at center ice or, hey, blow it down and yell out, I know that everybody doesn't hear exactly what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I'll talk to some guys later that maybe don't exactly know exactly the detail I'm talking about, but they know what I'm trying to get across. And it's tricky. Because I was just thinking about this the other day, because we're going through this. We won 12 of 13 on absolute fire. And And all along, I was like, enjoy this while it lasts. And I even mentioned it to management just to give them a little pre-warning. This isn't, we're not going to just roll like this through the rest of the season. We're going to have a dip. It always happens. And it's strange. It's always, when you get on a winning streak, almost always, at every level, there's not just one loss. There's several. You just kind of go off the rails. Usually, in my experience, it's because you get looser and looser and looser as you win, because everybody gets higher and higher and higher, and you get looser, and eventually it hits a breaking point and your game just isn't very good anymore. I don't really, because we kept on the guys, really on them and on them and on them, and that's why I think our streak lasted so long. But I didn't feel like we were getting looser. I think it's more circumstances on this one. You're never quite sure, but we lost a player he went to Czech. We had some injuries and sickness through the team, so our energy levels weren't there. But then all of a sudden we lost one, we lost another, and then we're not scoring. Just like that, we're not scoring. And then guys, then the game starts to change. Then we're trying to take too many risks offensively when that's not our game. And then we got to go back to showing video. Now back to square one. Here's our foundation. We rely on defense first hockey, and our offensive guys are cheating more because they're not scoring, and then we're allowing more chances. And that's the process we're going through right now. We've had this break, so we've worked on some stuff, and also just got some fresh air. And guys went on little trips to Budapest and stuff for a couple of days, and just one guy got engaged on his trip. And so you can see the feelings different right away when they came back from the trip. It's much more, because you start to lose, you feel the tension in the room. The tension comes out in the coaching staff too. Like, we start to get frustrated, and you try not to let that show, but you do. So it's fresh now and a fresh start. We haven't got it particularly healthier. We'll see how the next games go, but we'll get out of it. And everybody's calm about it. Our management is calm about it so far. but five losses in a row is not really normal for us. So we're going to get out of it. We just have to get back to our basic foundations of how we're supposed to play.
Well, I think everybody listening here, it's so funny, right? Like, can appreciate that as a coach, or you're just even as a player, that when you're winning, as you said, like, the swings that happen emotionally, because when you're winning, it feels like you can never lose. And then when you're losing, it feels like you can never win. Or when the puck's going in, it feels like every shot has a chance to go in. And that, you know, just, you know, so much of the game is between the ears. But what I find interesting is, like, you're going through five, the fact that you went through this exercise to call out that you've got this great dressing room. And as a coach, how do you evaluate, hey, this is, we need to kind of adjust things technically versus, like, hey, we might maybe not adjust things in the room, but maybe just, as you said, you just call out that, hey, you know, despite the circumstance, we got a great group of guys, and this is a great place to show up and come to work every day.
Yeah. Well, things get more tense when you lose. So more guys have more things they're thinking about and getting frustrated and saying and getting sensitive about certain things. And maybe, like, when a team is functioning extremely well, your fourth line's rolling, doing their job, and you're top two lines are scoring their goals, and everybody's happy. And then when the top guys aren't scoring as much, and maybe they start to play the wrong way a little bit, then the third and fourth line guys are like, I should be getting more. Why am I playing 8 minutes a game?
That's such a good point.
They're not doing their job. Yeah. So, and then everybody gets a little uncomfortable and there's tension. So the last days, we were having individual meetings with each guy, re-explaining their role and how it was super important. I mean, it's so important for the fourth line guys to know how important they are, because they are. I mean, we're not just saying that so we have four good lines. They are super important, especially even more important when the team's struggling, because they're the energy providers. When it's a little low energy and confidence a little low, they're the guys who are going to go out there and hit somebody and have a great shift and bring up the energy. So that was a point we had for our third and fourth line guys the last couple of days. And then the top guys got to get back to, you know, they can't let their game slide. Those offensive guys, they want to score so bad that their game defensively invariably slides to offense and too many risks. And then they get scored on more often, and then everybody says, so yeah, it's such a dynamic environment where everybody's got to just stay in their zone and their role, but to get back into this winning, the confidence in its role. And during that streak, I had a little period of time, and you're always hoping as a coach, you've probably felt it, where you really don't have to do much.
Yeah.
You know, the team's just rolling so well that you're doing your stuff and you're just showing your pre-scouts and you're correcting small things. But if you didn't do that, you feel like they will probably win anyway. Like you're getting all the luck. We got outplayed a few of those games and won anyway.
Yeah. And I think it works the other way too, where like when things are going south, it's so easy to overcorrect or to do too much. I think I really believe that that's sort of like the coaching bug or the kind of rust that you get is because as much as you think it should be rinse and repeat every week, it never is. You're always kind of balancing.
Oh yeah.
The kind of the push and pull aspect. So just as I hear you talk, Dan, like I my sense is that, you had a lengthy playing career as well, and that it seems to be, it would seem to me that you sort of view some of these decisions you're making through a player's lens. Is that accurate?
Well, yeah. I mean, what I try to do and get an understanding with management wherever I go is that we need to treat the guys right. It's not about in Slovakia more than any other place because of the I would say the Russian influence from years and years ago, the communist era, there's still some of that hanging on, the threats, the major negativity if you lose. And that's how you motivate, by yelling, and that's not my style. But I need to make sure that management understands that we don't need that. Let us correct the guys in the way we see fit. And you guys, because management does get involved in some of these teams in every league, but particularly here that I've seen that management gets involved. And I mean, you hire guys, the coaches and the sport managers involved as well as a kind of extended part of the sport manager here is like the GM in North America. He's the guy who's signing players and taking care of the players. So right away, we need to know that we're not spoiling the players by giving them what they need. Like, for example, so I had a sport manager a couple of years ago who I said, we need to make them feel really comfortable that they're being taken care of. Especially you've got to worry about the wives too. They're coming over here from North America, let's say for the first time. They're in a weird environment. Maybe they're not that comfortable. We got to give them a nice apartment, nice clean apartment that where they got everything they need to be comfortable. And if they want $1,000 cappuccino maker, okay, that's too much. If they want a toaster for 30 euros, because toasters aren't as common here. If they want a toaster to make them feel comfortable, let's spend the 35 euros or 25 to get them a toaster. So that actually happened. I use toaster because that actually happened. My sport manager called me a few years ago and said, I'm not paying 25. We're spoiling these guys. I'm not paying 25 euros for a toaster for these. They go buy it themselves. I'm like, why would you pot that 25 euros is nothing to us. And it goes so far with them. That's something that they will remember. They're being taken care of by us. They're organization. This isn't just a business. We're dealing with emotions and people, and this is a game of passion. We gotta treat them the right way. So we're doing that here for sure. Yeah. I mean, in 2 years or a year and a half, we've got a reputation as being the best place to play in Slovakia. I mean, financially, that's part of it too, because we're always on time and everything's really up and up with the financial part. But also, we treat the guys the right way.
I would say that that's probably the most overwhelming feedback, both from players and coaches over in Europe, is one from players and just like, you know, friends that have gone over there to play. Like when you ask them about their experience, like it's never about the hockey stuff. It's purely on like, you know, if they're in a good spot where they're getting treated the right way, they're like, this place is awesome. But it's so easy. As you said, the things they gripe about are all the things you hear and you're like, man, that seems like that could have been easily corrected or fixed.
Yes.
Coming on the coaching process. Like I love, And I want to dive into your background a little bit, because I find that there's a creativity Whether you're coaching, you know, when we talked, so many of the NHL coaches we talked to start in the East Coast League. And I think my thesis is that being in that environment, you need to be creative because you don't have all the resources to make the players, to create a special environment and in an environment where players want to come in and give their all. And I sense it's very similar over there where you might have to, well, it could be a toaster, but it could be something simple in the dressing room or something you do on the road when you travel, but just that creativity to create that environment in that sense that, hey, that we've got your back.
Yeah. I mean, we have a great setup here with our strength coach and how much money does it cost to make sure that they have protein and vitamins and just little things? Like, we try to take care of all that, and our strength guys do a great job with it. And I've been on other teams that don't do that, that think that's not important. One team I was with didn't even have a strength guy. Like, that's crazy. Like, that, those are small things that you need to having a strength guy is not a small thing, but the whole process of it is so important for their mental well-being and for them to feel comfortable. They can't play at their best if they're uncomfortable, or especially if their wife is uncomfortable. That's worse, of course.
No, for sure. Yeah. No question is. And I think everybody can relate to that. And I think it's, you know, I think so often, you know, at least I've come to appreciate just through these conversations, like, we all hear about coaches being about the details. And I think when we hear that, we think, oh, well, that's, you know, kind of what happens on the ice and in practice, et cetera. But so much of that detail is just being mindful of the overall life, because these players, I mean, they're spending, you know, day to day, they're spending, you know, probably 5% of it with you. There's the other 95% of it, and you got to make sure that part. And if I'm being honest, I mean, I've got a good friend of mine, his son's playing in your league right now and came over first year in Europe, and it's been a learning experience. Like, he goes, just socially, like, you've got, you know, I've kind of was used to being kind of one of the, you know, the lead guys in the clubhouse, so to speak. And now all of a sudden he's not, and it's not as social because he's not married, and just dealing with all that kind of stuff. So, really interesting to hear you kind of lend your perspective on that.
Well, an interesting thing about that and the dressing room situation for the foreign guys, the imports, is that it's different here as well. The dynamics in the dressing room are different because there might be guys who don't speak very much English, but also the local or the home country guys are sensitive to the imports being treated differently.
Sure. Yeah. Interesting. Yeah.
If that happens, they will see it and they won't be happy about it. And it shouldn't happen. That wouldn't be right. So you got to be really careful to make sure that as of course, I'm going to, maybe it's easier for me to talk to the North American guys. We have shared stuff. We can talk about baseball or whatever, where I can't talk to the Slovaks about.
Yeah, I never thought about that. Yeah.
So I got to be really mindful of spending too much time or being too friendly. I don't know if that's the right word.
No, but just social, because you gotta talk to people too. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and I want to talk to everybody and be, you know, have a great relationship with every player. And part of that is talking about baseball with a couple of the import guys. But I don't want to overdo it and make a Slovak guy feel like he's not appreciated. So it really, that's a big takeaway and a difference, in huge difference in coaching in Europe as to coaching back home. I mean, you have to treat everybody similarly, but you don't have these clearly different group of players.
Well, I would say, like, again, this is just through more of an observational lens, that when you talk about the importance of character, one of the underlying areas where I think it's so impactful on a team is that not everybody does get treated the same. There's different, you know, it could be ice time, responsibilities, et cetera, roles. But when you have a player that maybe is treated differently because they are a really good player, they, you know, get more opportunities on the ice. If that player is a dick, that can cause a major fraction in the dressing room. But if that player is just a good dude and everybody respects him as a person, it's a lot easier for them, except import or not, that, hey, you know, so-and-so gets treated differently, but hey, they come here, they work hard, they treat everybody, they're nice to everybody.
That's
nothing
so
a right. Team when, yeah. And And I would, again, I just understanding a teeny tiny bit of the recruitment process to get players, obviously, while there's not maybe, you know, contractual promises made in terms of role, like a lot is maybe inferred during the recruitment process. So, you know, nobody wants to go to a situation and be told one thing and then have another. So again, I just sense that in your role, that that's maybe some of the underlying complexities of coaching over there. You know, just in terms of building a culture. Yeah.
It's interesting you bring that up, because that is a real mistake to tell guys they're guaranteed anything. Like we've lost players more so because, I mean, usually you bring in imports to be your scorers. I mean, we set up our team a bit differently. Like, I always want to have a solid two-way centerman, and they're hard to find with the Slovaks. So almost always I have an import guy or best face-off guy, our last minute. He's going to be playing center, and he's not a high flying skill guy. He's going to be just a solid two way guy. With the Slovaks, if I'm bringing in a guy, or this has happened with imports too, to be in a certain situation, I'm not going to tell him things that aren't true just to make sure he comes. Like that. And that's where a lot of teams don't do that. A lot of teams like, oh yeah, you'll be on the first power play, or you'll be getting a lot of ice time, top two lines, when you don't know. Like, you don't know before you. I mean, you have an idea of where guys are going to be, but I mean, we have to. You can't just sign 6D in our league. We don't have a farm system, so we have to have 8 good D. So if he's going to be on the bubble, 7, 8, 6, pretty much 5, 6, 7, 8 are kind of interchangeable. Yeah. I got to tell them, we lost a guy because I said, you're going to be battling for the 5-6 role. And that's it. I can't promise you. And he's like, well, I'm being promised somewhere else. And he went there. He's been traded from there. I think he wasn't happy or something. So it's just such a – I'd rather lose a guy than tell him something that's not true.
Well, if I wrote a book, again, and this is just purely from being a nerd when it comes to this stuff and really observationally, but like one of the chapters in the book of what makes a great coach is there is an art form to being brutally honest and transparent. And I think that good coaches, and I assume part of this is just through experience, are willing to let a player walk away versus being painted into a corner and saying something, making a promise that could come back and bite them in the ass. And it seems that once you've kind of developed that confidence and just being like, it seems that good. And this could be NCAA coaches that are recruiting. This could be junior A coaches, like whatever the level, it just seems universal that good coaches have the ability to say, hey, here's the situation, here's the opportunity. But there's a difference between painting a picture of an opportunity and making a commitment or a promise.
Yeah. Yeah. True. And that same kind of concept applies to how you deal with them on a day-to-day basis too, about being honest with the guys and not, the accountability and not telling them one thing and, you know, meaning another. And it's tough. Sometimes you have to tell guys something they don't want to hear. They usually appreciate that if it's from the right way, but also sometimes you can't tell them exactly what you're feeling as well. Yeah. So yeah, it's a fine line with trying to get the best out of guys.
So tell me about your experience coming up, and because you had, I would say, a very untraditional path as a player, which ultimately led to you coaching, but you played in the Western Ontario Hockey League, it's junior B. You go to the University of Windsor. It seems like your last year there, you start, you put up some great numbers, and then boom, you're in the IHL.
AHL, yeah.
Kentucky Thoroughblades. And I was just like, man, what a transition. Like, take me through that run.
Yeah, that was pretty wild. I was a late bloomer. I actually played junior C my last year of junior eligibility.
Really?
Yeah, we were playing junior B in Windsor for the Windsor Bulldogs, and Bell River Canadians were a powerhouse junior C team, and they offered some interesting packages and for a bunch of guys who were coming to the University of Windsor. And and they were going to Europe, and there it was an all expensive paid trip to play a couple games in Europe and have a blast. Most of us had never been to Europe before. So we're like, sure, it sounds great. So a bunch of junior B caliber players went and played for Bell River, and that was our first year, all of our first year university. And we lost like three games all season. We just dominated. It was unbelievable, super fun. So at that point, I was just playing for fun. I was intending to play for the University of Windsor Lancers, which went to the Lancers, was still really, really developing as a player. My first year with Windsor, I was third liner and, I don't know, got 16 points or whatever it was. And then my game just blossomed. I got stronger. I kind of focused a bit more on off ice training and stuff. Got a little more serious about it. And suddenly, so pretty interesting story about how I got kind of noticed. So I was an all Canadian. I had a great year. But John Ferguson Sr. lived, before he passed away, he lived in that area. So he just came to the rink to watch a game. He wasn't scout. He was a scout for San Jose at that time. And he wasn't there to scout anybody. He was just there to watch a game. And that was the last game I played. We lost that game, I think, and the season was over. And a few days later, I had an answering machine back in those days. And on my answering machine, it was flashing, so I pressed. And this is John Ferguson from the San Jose Sharks. We'd like to talk to you about coming down to Kentucky and playing for American Hockey League team. I thought it was a buddy. Wow. I thought it was a joke.
Wow.
At that time, I was just hoping to maybe play in the coast or go directly to Europe.
Yeah.
And or that year. Yeah, that was the year I went to teacher scholarship. So I'd already gone to university for an extra year so I could play hockey for another year.
And how old were you at this point? Like 24?
That was 97, so 24, yeah.
Yeah.
And so Fergie leaves a message. I thought it potentially was a joke, and then I listened to it more, and that voice, he had a John Ferguson voice. So I'm like, okay, that nobody could make up that voice. So I called him back, and he said, you're welcome to come down. We'd like to sign you on a PTO, and because they had a bunch of injuries. So I went down there, and that was a great organization. They're playing out of Rupp Arena.
Great logo too. You guys are in Rupp Arena. I didn't realize that.
Yeah, there was 18,000 fans in my second game I played there. It was incredible.
Holy cow!
Yeah, wow. So had a great experience, and then ended up signing a two-way. I was hoping to sign in the A, but I didn't, and signed a two-way with Portland Pirates.
Yeah.
Barry Trotz was the coach of Portland before, and then he was trying to, apparently, this is through my agent, I don't want to put words in Barry Trotz's mouth, but he apparently liked something, seen some video or something, so he wanted me to come to Portland. And then he got the job in Nashville, and then they signed me anyway, so I went to Portland, and then as a two-way guy, I didn't really have a spot on the team.
Yeah.
So they sent me down to Brough and Hampton Roads. And I played 2 years in the coast and mostly in a little bit in the A.
So, and then other notable coaches, you came up, I believe, when Providence wins the Calder Cup, you were around that organization.
Yeah.
And Peter Laviolette was the coach.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So in my first year in Portland, Brian Trotsche was the coach, which was just amazing to be being coached by Brian Trotsche, legend. Such a nice man too. I don't know if you've met Trotz, but
I haven't, but I you know, when you sort of, you hear people where like nobody's ever said a bad word about him, or just everybody goes out of the way to communicate how great of a person he is, like he's in that category.
So nice. So the next year I got called up to Providence after our season was over, played for Lavi, and that was a unbelievable team. They had some injuries too, so I went up there and played a few games, and then played the first couple of games of the quarterfinals, and then they got some guys back from injury, and then didn't end up playing anymore. But they won the Calder Cup, and it was incredible. Yeah, it was a great experience.
And just curious, like there's a couple of iconic names there for coaches, but when you look back in hindsight of you know, when you made the transition to coaching, what might have been some observations that you made from some of those people, again, before, especially in Peter's case, before they go onto the National Hockey League and have all that success? But would you say, I'm gonna pull this into how I operate?
I think his reputation, I think now, is kind of a gruff kind of guy. I think that's all because he's got a very stern look on the bench, because he was an excellent guy. Like he really treated the players well, and he really read the room well.
Yeah.
That was a big strength of his. He read the room. He treated everybody well. He had a lot of energy all the time. So I wouldn't call him a disciplinarian at all. Like he was, you know, he's got the look. Like you want to do what he tells you to do for sure. But he wasn't yelling at guys or anything like that. He was a real good communicator and really easy to talk to. I remember, so there were about three games left, I think, and we had a chance to be the best record in the history of the American Hockey League. They had an unbelievable year. And I was just there for a few games. I was just doing whatever anybody asked me to do to try to help. And so it was tense. Everybody, the pressure all of a sudden was on to win this game. I think there were two games left maybe, and they had to win one to have the best record ever. And he came in, and he realized that it was extra tense in the room. So right before the game, he said, we had a tough guy named Roger Maxwell, and came in, and he said, "Rog, what's 2 + 2? 4. What's the letter after B? C. What do you put in a toaster? Toast." Yeah. "No, it's bread, you." It was a little more comfortable, colorful the way he worded it. "No, it's bread, you." And everybody laughed. It was a perfect thing to do. Everybody laughed and relaxed and went out and won. It was, I love that
you
story.
Guys, they took the record. You guys took the record.
Yeah, wow. Yeah.
That's a great story. That's awesome. That's awesome. And then, you know, of course, you go over to Europe, playing a couple leagues, you win a few championships. And I feel like I'm sure that we could be on here for the next couple hours reliving that. But, you know, again, if I wrote my book on coaching, another thing that might be in there, it's like you know, highly advisable to go be a player coach somewhere. And you had that experience with the Dundee Stars. And let's start here. Can you take me in to the conversation where, I don't know if it's a GM or ownership, but they say, "Hey, Dan, we want you to come in here and be the coach and play for us."
What an unbelievable experience that was. So I'm getting older and in my career, and I was the captain of Sønderjyske in Denmark. And like you said, we won a couple championships. Yeah. And then they decided that it wasn't my time anymore. So suddenly I had to, and I've been thinking, like, as a captain for a few years, I was kind of going into that role. I even ran a few practices, and I was really talking a lot with the young guys and helping them. I was 36 or 5 or something. So yeah, 36. So then all of a sudden I had to figure out what my next move was. And in the UK at that time, and I had a history in the UK. I'd played in Bracknell for 3 years and played in Sheffield and played in Nottingham. So 4 years in the UK. And I knew some people who were running some teams. Todd Kelman, who's now in Cardiff, was in Belfast at the time. So I asked him, "Well, what do you think?" And he's like, "Yeah, you should be a player coach. And there's a few teams that are looking." And Dundee was an expansion team. It was their first year in the league. And they're like, it's not going to be easy. You're not going to win many games, but it'll be a cool experience. And I thought that's a perfect place to go, because I'm pretty sure I want to be a coach, but I'm not 100% sure. I really think that's what I want to do, but I want to keep playing too. So talk to their ownership. They had no GM or anybody. The owner I talked to is a plumber. They're still there. The Ward Brummers. They're contractors. Like the two brothers do well, but they're certainly not loaded, rich by any means.
Sure.
Just humble guys. And so had a great talk and got hired. And basically, they gave me a budget. At the time, UK, some teams do this in UK, they pay by the week. You negotiate on a weekly basis and you get 30 weeks. And you know what. So they gave me my weekly budget. And I had to build a team with zero players. So I had to just
how many of those players had to be like from Britain or the
I think right now it's 14. What was it at that time? It was around that.
Yeah.
12 or 14 imports. And I mean there were very few Scottish guys who could play at that level. So immediately, I mean they took care of that. They signed a couple, like two Scottish guys who could play. And I didn't. I knew my agent. I knew maybe one other agent. So I didn't know how to build a team, to talk to. So I had to throw myself into it. I got a list of agents from a friend of mine, which was nice. And then I just started figuring out how to, you know, recruit a team. There was no Instat at that time. And even if there was, we wouldn't have been able to afford the Instat. So, and I'm just phone calls,
really?
and trying to build a budget. So I learned, and I was involved in like the bus, renting the bus,
and
ice schedules. There was curling on Tuesdays, so we didn't skate on Mondays. If we play Saturday, Sunday, Monday's off, it has to be. Tuesday was curling, so we couldn't skate on Tuesday either. So it was a gym session on Tuesday. So, I mean, even helping with the equipment, by sourcing equipment, it was complete learning, unbelievable learning experience, just accelerated so fast because of all the different things I had to do. I mean, that I realized right away that I enjoyed the team building part of it, and that's why now to this day I'm still really involved. I would really struggle if the GM of a team that I was hired said, "I do all the hiring, you just coach the team." I would struggle with that because first I'm a control freak, and secondly, I really enjoy that part of it, finding the right guys and putting the right mix together. So I found that right away, and then the coaching part was, I realized I liked it right away. We had no bench coach. I got a lot of stories from that year, but we had no bench coach. So I was, most teams with a player coach at that time had a guy running the bench during games, but we couldn't find one. I mean, there's nobody qualified to do it in Dundee. So I was calling out lines. I had to call lines too. If I was in the penalty box, I wasn't a guy who got a lot of penalties, but if I was in the box, I had to be yelling over who's up next. The D kind of basically ran themselves, and I was running the forwards. I mean, I got a lot of power play time. Yeah, I called my own number on the I was PP1 for sure.
Oh, but my God. Yeah.
It was a great, great experience. We had a good group. We had a colorful group, too, a really interesting group of guys. We had a good central hockey. They weren't making much money, so we had a tough – so I decided to make a tough team. So we had Sean McMorrow, Sean the Sheriff McMorrow, big, super tough, the toughest human being I've ever met. We had Steve McQuay. We had Matt Suderman. We had a super tough team, and it sold some tickets.
I was going to say, yeah, I bet it did. So, it sounds like somebody needs to turn this into like a sitcom or like a TV series, just like, you know, playing hockey over in Britain. And because I can just imagine the characters and the stories that come out of that. But from a coaching perspective, two things, you know, you talk about when you guys are going on a bit of a dip as you are now, you know, the ability to stay calm. And I believe that there's real value that I would seem as a young coach, because I think you guys lost your first 16 that year, if I read correctly. But the fact that you go through that early and sort of, I got to imagine your skin gets a lot thicker in the process. Like, how valuable to come out the other side of something like that is it, you know, when you go through that today?
Yeah, I mean, that was another part of that year. We couldn't win a game, 16 games in a row. That was brutal. We just, I made too tough a team. I mean, end up having to fire my first player that I had to fire was, and it was Sean McMorrow. He does a very popular podcast too. Good man. And he handled it really well, but that particular story is a good one because we called him in. He had an idea. He'd been around. He had an idea what was going on, and he was not happy at that moment that we said we got to make some changes. And my assistant coach Brent Hughes, who's a coach, but so Brent and I had to, and Sean's sitting there, 6'4", big guy, sitting there, and we're like, we got to let you go. And that was all part of the whole experience that year. And he was not really very receptive to that information. I think I haven't talked to Sean in a while, but he'd probably laugh about that story. He basically said, no, I'm not going. So we're like, okay. And he left, and the owner called me, and I said, he said no. He said he's not going. What? So, we figured out how to do that. But, we ended up bringing in a little more skill and getting a little bit better. And, that was my first major opportunity to deal with a losing streak.
Wow. And then, I understand that year, and correct me if I'm off here, but my understanding is that you were let go as the player coach. You end up going to, is it Fife, and you become the captain there. But I find this interesting because, it's late in your career. You go through this player coach thing. It's obviously a challenge. You get let go. You go to another team. Like
that was that first year
to coach. Yeah. You still wanted to coach.
Yeah. So that first year went by, we got out of our losing streak and we ended up making the playoffs. So it was a really, really good. Yeah. That was a beautiful end to that story. We lost in the first round of the playoffs, but it was just making the playoffs. It was incredible. It was a real fun group of guys. Like, I got some stories that probably I can't tell those stories, but a real fun loving group of guys. So I had to be that was different too, being a player coach, because I mean, you get, first of all, you got to play the way you're preaching.
It makes sense.
So AJ McLean was one of my players who's a coach. With the Marlies, and it's a hockey family and a great hockey guy. And I remember early on, I said, like, we can't turn over the puck, the offensive blue line. And then I was one of the more skilled guys.
Oh, so I would have been a terrible player coach.
And so I turned over the puck and he's like, Dan, if you're saying it, you can't do it. I'm like, you're exactly totally right. Like, you're right. So, and then the other thing about player coach was you're sitting in the dressing room with the guys. You can't berate anybody. You have to, it's got to be a bit different. You can't, because you're sitting there tying your skates, you can't stand up and say, hey guys, are awful. Or you, because you're part of it. So it's a completely different approach. It's being a more of a captain who runs the lines kind of thing. So the next year we had a higher expectations, a little more money, and we still didn't have a great team. So we had a rough patch there and I got fired. And went to Fife, and then with the Fife was fun, good, nice group of people there. And then I thought, towards the end of that year, even when I was still in Dundee, I was like, I'm enjoying coaching much more than I'm enjoying playing. The challenge of it, and the video, and the details, and all that. And playing was getting to be a chore to get my body. I was 38. Getting my body going, getting massages every day, but I was just wasting time on the massage table because I wanted to watch video. And we had no video system. I was just watching it on Windows Media Player and writing down the time that I had to shoot. that's when I realized I'm really enjoying this coaching. So we looked around and my old team that I played for 4 years in Denmark, we're looking for an assistant coach. And I thought I'd be a good match with Mario Simeone, who I played for. And then
he's a bit of a legend over there. Great career over there. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Won a bunch of championships, won some with me, won some before me. And then, so I came back and we won a championship together again. And it was really interesting. So as a player, how should I put this? Mario was a disciplinarian, emotional guy who's hard on his players. And I had some disagreements with him as a player. As an assistant coach, I loved being around him. Super charismatic guy, funny. So we had a great year that year. And then he ended up leaving, and I took over for him. And then that was basically the real start in my mind of my professional coaching career. The player coaching was really interesting and fun and a great start. But when I got behind the bench, that was really the start of my coaching career.
Well, oh man, we're gonna have to get you back on. I keep hearing like there's more stories here.
Sure.
you win a championship in Denmark too, right away. Then you go to obviously your first go around in Slovakia. You win a championship. You do it again last year in your first full season. But you've also had, you know, you talk about, you know, in Linz where you've got kind of a short run there. What would be, if you were speaking, and you are speaking to a group of coaches that, you know, if they're not in your shoes today, then they aspire to be at some point. What would be the advice in particular? I just, you know, the teams that have had success, what happened, what went right, or what did you do that was right to have success in those situations?
Yeah. First of all, researching the team you're going to is very, very important. I mean, that's number one. If you're interviewing with a team that's had five coaches in the last 3 years, which I did in VLOC, yep, then there's a good chance you're not going to be there especially if you sign a 1 year deal.
Yeah, no kidding.
then you got to be prepared. If you're willing to take that risk, I mean, what your family situation is, or if you have a super supportive wife, girlfriend, whatever it is, if you're a single person, that's obviously easier. You're more flexible. All of that goes into it. If you're not prepared to go into a situation that, every situation you could get fired, there's for sure. But if you're going into an organization that you're not confident in, then either know what you're getting into. And if you have a family, really, really know what you're getting into. And if you aren't willing to take that risk, then don't do it. And so that's what I learned in my Austrian 2 years, was that I didn't have a group, nothing. I'm not, the organization in VLOC is fine. The situation I got into, without going into details, was not great. They didn't re-sign the coach they really wanted. So I was on thin ice right away. So, and I felt that, and I thought, it'll be fine. I'm a good coach. I'll just get through it. And it was also COVID. That was the first year of COVID. So I was just happy to get a job. But in retrospect, I wasn't comfortable. I shouldn't have taken that job. And then I rushed in because I wanted another job quick, because I just got fired. I rushed into the Linz job, which was fun. I had a good time in Linz. Nice people, great place to live. But it was a very unstable environment I was going into financially. They had new owner. A lot of controversial things going on there. It wasn't a stable environment. So do your research, like make the calls. When I did a much better job of doing research when I went to Banska Bystrica. I made a lot of phone calls. I knew basically what I was getting into. It was still kind of a jump to go to Slovakia with some practices of others. You hear some bad stuff about Slovakia. I made sure that Banska wasn't doing any of those things. There are some unprofessional teams in our league, unfortunately, that give us all a bad name, which frustrates me to no end. But Banska was very comfortable going to, and had an unbelievable experience. And the Koval family were owners at that time, and I owe them a lot. But that's the first thing. Know what you're getting into and be comfortable with it. If it's not something that you're comfortable with, then don't do it. There's teams that fire coaches every year, and they're not I mean, I wouldn't recommend going to those teams. And then as far as hockey-wise, be very cognizant of that you're also bringing in a culture. You have to be the culture builder. There's not many teams in Europe that have an ingrained culture already. There are some teams, I'm sure, in Sweden, hockey culture, hockey team, hockey, big hockey powerhouses like Skellefteå.
How do you define culture? Now. How do you define culture?
That's a good question. The overall atmosphere and values that you want to bring, that you want your team from management down to uphold. And the management part is hard because you don't have control over them. And that's why I wanted that short time here in Košice with just a very short-term contract. And I got to know these guys, that they're good people. They still might be emotional, but they're good people and they want to do what's right. And they're pros, like they're very businesslike. We're the most professional team in the league, and that's gotten better in the last 2 years. But they were already very financially or very professional. So from the top down, the atmosphere in the values that you want to uphold every day. So my favorite word for hockey is humble. How I want my players to act.
Yeah.
And part of that is who we're recruiting. I mean, we're not bringing any egotistical idiots, but we want to be humble every day, no matter. And that's also, of course, you want to be that when you're a successful team, when you expect success. We talked about, it became a mantra for us last year because it's on our wall, the Košice way. I stole that from Frölunda, the Frölunda way. I'm sure lots of teams have their way.
For sure.
And that's, we got to, 10 points that it gets into a little bit about how we want to play as well, being hard to play against and physical. But the first 7 points are how we want to act. And we want to act with honor. We want to be humble. Number one is being humble in our nature every day, hardworking and humble. And so that's the culture we want to be. Nobody's better. Nobody has a bigger ego than anybody else. And we don't get too high on ourselves. As a top team, an expected top team, that's a big thing that we fight against, is getting too high in ourselves, and that's when things slide, and that's when cracks can come into the dressing room, when there's some guys are too high and other guys aren't happy with that. And so we really so last year, the second half of the season, after our mid-season winning streak, it became a mantra. After we won, we had the tradition everybody has. The guy gives the next guy the whatever, you have some we have a cowboy hat you put on, and you give the next guy the player of the game.
That is, do you guys have a cowboy hat over there? That's your thing?
Yeah, we had I think we just kept our hat from last year. But yeah, there's always some interesting things. We had a gladiator mask at one point. But they would say, okay, boys, keep rolling and stay humble. Everybody was constantly saying, stay humble, stay humble, stay humble. Yeah, so that's a big part of our culture here.
That's awesome. Dan, that's a great place to close. Hey, listen, it's great. I know we've sort of been pen pals of sorts over the last years, and just admiring, the work that you've done, and glad we got to connect and share a bit of your story today. This was awesome.
Thanks, Aaron. And I just want to say it's been a privilege to be on your podcast, and from all of the coaches around, you're just doing an amazing job. We're so appreciative of the coaches' site and what you guys do.